Thank you, Dick, and thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure for me to talk here, to be introduced by Dick. It's a real achievement. Dick has been my idol for many years. I'm going to talk about cause and effect, and many of you heard me talk about this topic, so I decided to sprinkle it with a few words on machine learning and logic of science to keep you awake. And I'll start with a revolution, something that I perceive to be a revolution that took place in the causal reasoning sphere. And the reason I call it a revolution can be attested by superficial numbers. For instance, in 2001, the number of papers published in the JSM, that is a joint statistical meeting of ACM, number of papers that had causality in their title was 13. Last year, it measured to the 130, so it's tenfold increase, and to this year it's over 200. But this is superficial counting. The deeper indication that there has been a revolution is when authors start advertising their paper in terms of causality, like a title such as "A causally sound approach to XYZ," or "A causally based approach to ZXY." Okay? Then you know that it hits some deep chord in the mind of people. That causality have gone from being a liability to being an asset. It is a word by which you beg for respectability. So that is a revolution, and this happened not in computer science. It happened in the social science, the medical sciences, in econometrics, in the other departments around Berkeley, okay, that you might meet on lunchtime. Okay. So this transition, I attribute it to two elements. One is a commitment to ask questions about reality, not about data. So you ask a question about what should reality be like for me to observe what I observe? What should reality be like so that my algorithm will work most of the time? And this courage to talk about reality is something very new in the other departments. It's not very new in science, but it's very new in the department which are heavily data-driven. Okay. If you read the manifesto of the Royal Statistical Society that came out in 1831, you find the declaration that we will not publish any paper which is based on opinion. We count only data, data, and data. So that has been the lifeline of statistical science, and all the sciences that depend on statistics for respectability, including econometrics, including medical science, and so on. And there has been a transition from statistics to counterfactual, and I'll talk about the counterfactual. And the second commitment is to, when you say, I want to know what kind of reality will guarantee performance of my algorithm, the language in which you describe reality is not the language of a probability distribution, but the language of physics or generating function. What algorithm or mechanism can generate the data? That has been the two elements to which I attribute the transition of respectability in the statistically dominated sciences. And I liken it to the transition from Babylonian to Greek science. There is a book by Ptolemy who tells us that the Babylonian far surpassed the Greeks in accuracy and consistency of prediction. They could predict the rise of the moon and even the eclipse of Venus, whatever, with much greater accuracy than the Greeks. And how they did it? By time series extrapolation, interpolation, extrapolation, something like Fourier series, but not really, because they didn't have the idea of Fourier analysis, but by polynomial fitting. And the Greeks' science was based on totally metaphorical, crazy, metaphysical images. We walk on the shell of a turtle. Okay? The stars are not really stars. They are holes poked in the opaque shell through which we can see the eternal fire coming in. It was totally based on everyday metaphor. Okay? But it was the Greek science that prevailed. Today, we subscribe to the Greek science, and it was the Greek science, not the Babylonian, that forced Eratosthenes in about 200 BC to go down to Egypt and, or he lived in Alexandria, okay, to measure the sun rays at noontime at two different wells, one in Alexandria, one near Aswan, and measure the difference in the angle and measure the radius of the world. That's something that wouldn't occur to Babylonian black box curve-fitting scientist. I like to liken the revolution that took place in the causality business to that which took place in sciences. And that leads me to other speculations. I'll be able to convey to you everything that I know in terms of two principles. And if you get these two principles, then you can derive on your own everything that I knew, know, and will know, I hope, I think, yeah, about causality. So that would be a second part of my talk. And the third, I'll talk about application. Because if it's just a matter of scientific speculation, it wouldn't have given rise to a change of mindset of so many scientists. So, and here you can see the role of computer science in getting down to areas that were dominated by vocabulary, social science type of vocabulary, and become dominated by computer science type of vocabulary. And the achievements there, or the results that we have there, will be in policy evaluation, in assigning credit and blame to events, what actually caused that, and to mediation, the difference between direct effect and indirect effect. And you know how important it is. You send people to the electric chair if they are directly responsible for the killing, and only for so many years in prison if they are indirectly related. So it's extremely important in the way we think about what's happening in our environment. And the two new applications that I would like to spend some time on, because I'm still excited, so forgive me for indulging you more than 2 minutes on each, that would be generalizability or thermal variability, validity, namely under what condition we can take result of experiments in one environment and believe that it's going to work in another environment. Not literally work, but combined with what we know, with what we measured in the two environments, we can synthesize an estimator for the new environment and prove that it is unbiased and has all nice features that one wants. And the last one is missing data, because I like to talk about it, because just recently we did some work and we found that an application area of that type that has been fairly entrenched in statistical literature is really not a statistical problem at all. It's a causal problem. And you can get a lot of insight by looking at it from the causal reasoning viewpoint. Okay, let us start with Turing, of course. Who doesn't want to start with Turing? And this is what Turing said in the 1950s famous paper, Can Machine Think, about learning. He said, why don't we start the machine as a child? The only rudimentary knowledge about the world and have the machine learn on itself. And then he said, it's very much like evolution. I'm glad you gave us the introduction, Christos. But he said the survival of the fittest is a slow method for measuring advantages. The experimenter, and by that I mean either a programmer or the guy who tests the Turing test, okay, by exercise of intelligence should be able to speed it up. And then he explicates what he means by speeding it up. If he can trace the cause of some weaknesses, I mean, in the algorithm or in the performance, he can probably think of the kind of mutation which will improve it. Okay? So what is the important thing is to notice that he attributes that speed up process to exercise of intelligence. And indeed, we are looking at the evolution and we see millions of years of nice performance, slow but nice performance. Okay. The vision system of the eagle and the snake can outperform everything that we can make in the laboratory. It was a great achievement. But snakes and eagles cannot build an eyeglass or a telescope or a microscope. So there has something else happened in the history of evolution. The invention of reasoning by the Greek. Okay. And look at the speed up. Look what we have achieved in the past 2,000 years as opposed to what evolution has achieved in the past 2 million years. Okay. It's enormous in terms of the curve, in the steepness of the curve. So what is that element which we call, what Turing called exercise of intelligence? That's reasoning. Okay. Reasoning goes from assumptions to conclusions by a certain rule. Big deal. It's just mechanical, right? But the Greek had the idea that if you build in this mechanical transformation from assumptions to conclusions, it's going to help you in achieving things that you wouldn't be able to do with time with a curve fitting. So that's what my lesson for machine learning. And I will now be quick. Look at why I'm focusing on a causal reasoning. AI has many applications. Some of them are realizable, and some of them are still in the dream state. But causal reasoning really impinges on several important areas. First, it impinges on our entire cognition and sense of ethics, sense of justice. It's also important for scientific thinking. I'll convince you in a couple of slides. And on robotics, and the area where I spent in the past few years is data in intensive scientific application. All these hundreds and thousands of hungry and aimless customers that are waiting for insight about cause and effect. They are being paid for cause and effect, and all they can deliver is correlations. So I'm talking about those elements, those people. Okay, let's start with the human cognition and ethics, and there's no better slides to prove to you that it is at the heart of our cognition than to start with the Bible. When God tells Abraham, hey, did you eat from that tree that I told you not to eat? And Adam, look at what he says. She handed me the fruit and I ate. He already translated into credit assignment, credit and blame assignment. It's not me. She had it, okay? So here's the passing the buck. And Eve is not less proficient in causal argumentation. And she said, me? It's a serpent. That shows you how deep, at least the author of the Bible, thought cause-effect dominates our cognition and our sense of justice. You remember when Abraham heard that God is about to destroy the two cities, the wicked city of Sodom and Gomorrah, he said, come on, come on, you can't do that. Are you about to smite the righteous with the wicked? Hatispeh tzadikim rasha, it goes in Hebrew. And what if there were 50 righteous men in the city? That's a counterfactual. What if they were? Obviously, if God is going to smite them, there aren't 50. So what do you mean, if they were? Okay? And then the Lord says, if I find in the city of Dom 50 good men, I will pardon the whole place for their sake. And so God strangely understands the counterfactual question. Even though it's obvious that God has counted things, that God can decide who is wicked and who, and they didn't pass the threshold. So what is the idea of asking questions like that? Well, my interpretation is that Abraham was the first scientist, because he's asking not for this particular city. He's begging to understand the law of collective punishment. Under what conditions, you know, a city will be destroyed for on account of few wicked people. Okay, so that's what makes him a first scientist. And it's the first place where I found counterfactual, if they were. Okay. And it's no wonder that counterfactuals are indicative of scientific thinking. If I look at what scientific thinking is, I find that in my physics books, everything is counterfactual. If anyone tells you that physics is just a bunch of equations, and the equations are algebraic, it ain't so. And I can prove it to you immediately in 2 seconds that the equations of physics are not algebraic. Here is the proof. You may look at Hooke's law, okay, or Ohm's law, or Joule's law, whatever law you take from physics. Okay, here it says that the length of the spring is going to be a constant times the weight that you hang on it. And suppose the weight is 1 kilogram now. Okay, so this gives you a couple of equations. You can solve it. Every high school kid solves it. But is this equivalent to these couple of equations? Is this equivalent to this couple of equations, alternative? They all have the same solution. My algebra book tells me two systems of algebraic equations are equivalent if they preserve solutions, right? So these equations, these three alternatives preserve solutions. However, do they preserve information? Is there information you can get from here that you cannot get from here or from here? Of course there is. And where does it reflect? If I were to ask you, how about if the weight were 3, not 1? You can answer it from here. You cannot answer it from any of the others, right? Had x been 3, y would be 6. You can do it from here and not from any. Conclusion, the semantics of this equation have never been algebraic. It were counterfactual. So if you go back to your physics, you find that that is how you solve problems in high school, and without thinking about it. But when we have to put it on a computer, we have to think about it, because the computer will scream here, what do you mean x is equal to 3? Contradiction. So you have to wipe up the equation. In this case, it will be that equation. Replace it by x equal to 3, solve a new system of equations, and get an A+. So this wiping out really means that equation is not algebraic, but an assignment. Okay. Nature looks at the weight and decides on the value that the length should attain. Okay, I will just go straight to robotic, because that's where it counts. A robot must know cause-effect relationship. If you expect a robot to repair things in the laboratory or kitchen when things do not go as expected. And cause-effect relation is the mechanism, the reasoning, by which you can repair things. That is what we mean by understand. You understand how TV works only when you can repair it, when it doesn't work. Not when you turn the knob regularly, as told you by the salesman. So what kind of questions we want this robot to answer? First, observational question, that easy. What if I see something? That is handled by ordinary statistics. You want action questions. What if I do A? A is one of the actions available to the robot, moving arm or whatever. All kinds of factual questions. What if I did things differently? That's how you repair things, or you repair yourself. Okay? The milk spilled. What if I did things differently? Okay? That is how you avoid spilling the milk the next time. An option with what probability that if you want to be a purist and you can decorate everything with probability. Now I'm coming to this area where I told you that I spent a few years in data intensive scientific applications. It turns out that every insight we get by trying to teach robot a cause-effect relationship, okay, we have customers for in this area, in those departments. What happens in those departments? They started with statistics. Statistics has a very simple paradigm. Behind the curtain, you have an oracle, a joint probability distribution of all the variables that you can ever observe. And sitting right there, spits out data once in a while. Your job is to take the data and to infer properties of the oracle. Q of P, aspect of P, for instance, infer whether customers who bought product A would also buy product B. Many people in Google are working and making good money on solving this problem. Of course, A and B are not just two propositions. They are complex vector of events and factors and so on. But in causality land, we have a different kind of questions that we are trying to answer. Estimate the probability of cancer if we ban smoking. Okay. Now, we never banned smoking completely. We might have banned smoking in a small laboratory. And here is comes the question, estimate the probability of cancer if we ban smoking when we have data coming from the world in which smoking was not banned. So it's a different kind of probability. We get the data from P, and we want to predict something about the new world in which smoking is banned. So we have to find properties of P prime. Okay. Who is the guy that decides how to change P into P prime according to this very succinct kind of instruction? Ban smoking. It's a description of an action, which is a description of the change that is expected here. Okay. And who is the guy that takes this succinct description of an action and translate it into a new probability distribution, P prime? That must be some very sophisticated kind of oracle. And let's go one step further and think about counterfactual terms. Estimate the probability that the customer who bought product A would buy B if we were to double the price. Okay. The price wasn't double. But we are greedy today, so we are trying to figure out if we couldn't make more money by doubling the price. Okay. There is a new probability that needs to be, and there is an oracle that ought to answer those questions. Okay, let's do it. Together we can all answer them because we know that the equation of physics are nothing but counterfactual. Let's go back to physics and answer it. I call that oracle data generating model. That's what it means. It's a strategy or mechanism, recipe, or so on, by which nature assigns values to variables in the analysis. Once you declare that to be the oracle, which governs the joint distribution that you see, you estimate, whose property you're really after, you're trying to find property not of the joint distribution, but of the data generating model, it's a painful decrowning of a beloved oracle. So painful indeed that it took a century to erase the original manifesto of Statistical Royal Society in 1831 and to replace it with something more reasonable. I mean, they haven't done it yet. I'm waiting for them to declare officially and publicly that the decision to eliminate opinion from their publications was a hasty one. Now we can ask the same question we ask about the robot, we can ask to the oracle. What kind of questions the oracle must answer? We have the same list, but when we do it formally, we find something interesting. We find that one, that we have a nice signature in human language. We call it what is, what if, and here we call it why. Second, we find that it forms a hierarchy. A hierarchy in the sense that we under very light leakage between the layers, in the following sense, that if you want to prove a conclusion in layer I, you must have assumptions from layers I or higher. And that means that if you don't have a causal assumptions in layer two, you cannot get any causal conclusion. You cannot get any causal conclusion from observation alone. Nor can you get answers to counterfactual questions from randomized experiment, from doing things. You need something extra. Okay. And they have a syntactic signature. That is straight probability, PY given A, given. That's a Bayesian conditioning bar, the famous one that people adapted to describe, given that I see, given that I know. And then you have other kind of bars. Here, for instance, you have P of Y given that I do A, and here you have a subscript. Probability that, that I observed A, what would be the probability of Y had A been A prime and not A? I observe a guy smoking and I ask, what's the probability of cancer had he not smoked? So that is the kind of, that's the game we are going to play now. And the nice thing about it is it's, okay, first I summarize what I said in a form of a Plato cave. Here we are, mortals. This is what we observe with our own eyes. But this is nothing but the shadows of three-dimensional objects that are being held by the players. Some of them are chairs. Now, if you really want to be a purist, namely to be welcomed by statistician, then you will build a calculus of shadows. You'll observe the shadow and think, what are constraints in their movement, in their interaction? Sometimes they bounce from each other, sometimes they pass each other. You can build a calculus like that. That's what statistics is. But then if you go down to to the Greeks, and ask the celestial motions, can they be attributed to something that is familiar to us, like turtles, like pokes in the sky? Then you imagine that these are nothing but reflection of unobservable, but something that I'm familiar with. And with this leap of imagination, you can do much more. And that is what I'm going to show. This is my turtle. This is what you imagine. It's a world full of springs, like the Hooke's law springs. Every variable is connected to other variables via functions. Every variable attains its value, small vi, through a function of other variables of its kind, plus the U's, which are background factors, boundary conditions. And these all schmear of collection of functions interact with feedback, without feedback, and give you what we see today. The temperature here is 31 degrees, the temperature, pressure there is so much. And this is we just imagine now that nature determines those values that we measure via functions, deterministic functions. And where does uncertainty come from? From the fact that we don't know the boundary condition. So our uncertainty comes from ignorance. It's a Laplacian model, not Heisenberg. It comes from ignorance about the boundary condition. If you assign probability to the boundary condition to use, then it propagates, maps into a probability on the observable, and this is what we see. Okay, this would not be a remedy had it not been, and I'm using counterfactual, for two gifts of nature. Nature gives us two gifts, which I'm going to expound. Now, we don't have any economists here, so I don't have to explain why this is not a regression equation. It's a structural equation. But the nice thing is that counterfactuals now have semantics. I can define what I mean by the truth value of the following sentence. Y would be small y in situation u had x been small x. This sentence is true if you mutilate the mud and you replace the equation that previously determined the value of x, the antecedent, by a constant, and you solve it, and you get the solution y is equal to small y, then you say the sentence is true in our world. If you get some y prime, then you say it's false. Okay? Now we have semantics. For us, computer scientists, we have semantics. It's 95% of the solution. Right? So it's done. Almost. we still have to compute it. So we need effective algorithm to figure out the solutions and to answer more sophisticated questions, like when can we uncover it from pure data? We don't see the functions. We don't see the probability of the use. All we see is the data, P of V. But these are later stage. We will be able to solve those questions if we only understand the semantics. So here it is description in graph form. You have a bunch of equations. Currently, you have x and you have y. If you ask, what will be y had x been small x? Very simple. High school algebra. Cut off the equation that previously determined x, replace it by a constant, solve the mutilated model, and find the solution for y. This is what we mean by y sub x of u. Had x been x. So this is I call it the fundamental equation of counterfactual. You can tell everything about counterfactual, all questions, if you had this model. We don't have the model, we have to do some tricks, computational tricks. Okay, so here are I'm coming to the two fundamental laws. First, I just talked about. The model generates and evaluates all counterfactuals. And if you have probability on the use, it's probability on the counterfactual. So you can talk about counterfactual with all the machinery of probability theory. You have conditional probability on counterfactual. You have independence, conditional independence. One counterfactual is independent on another given a third, and so on. The second is a law of conditional independence. It's also a miracle that nature doesn't hide its structure totally. It gives us some clue about its structure. And this is the following. It goes like that. Every time you see separation in the graph, the graph is nothing else but an abstraction of the model where you only show which variables are argument for which. Okay? Only the line being argument of. That's what the graph stands for. So if you have separation in the model, you can infer independence. It imposes independence on the distribution that you see. So you see, nature gave us a gift of tracing it. Here's an example. Imagine that you have here four variables. These are the four functions. This is a graph that's coming out from it, telling you that I don't know the functions, and I don't know the problem. I don't have anything quantitative, only qualitative. Okay? This is how I describe my work. Now, and I'm aware of the fact that every arrow here summarizes millions of microprocesses, very complex with the feedback and so on. But despite all this complexity, the gift of the God is as follows. If the U's here are independent, then the observed distribution must satisfy constraints that are, one, independent on the functions. So you can have very crazy function here. obviously discrete is fine, and it's readable from readable from the graph. How? Every time you see a missing arrow, you have a separation. You can't go from here to here without going through SNR. So I know right away that the variable climate is independent on a variable wetness, condition on the sprinkler being on and the rain being on. Here you have, okay? And so on for the other missing link and on. What does it give you? Application? Well, model testing. Nature tells you, this is my signature. If you find data that refutes one of the testable implications, you know the model is wrong. Moreover, you can talk about structural learning. What about several models fit the data? You can actually prune all the models that do not not compatible with the data and have a nice description of those that do comply with the data. And then you can ask all kind of nice questions, like do they all agree on one query, and other kind of tricks. And the third application is it can reduce the question of what if I do to symbolic calculus. And I'll show you that in a second. Also reduce scientific question involving counterfactual to symbolic calculus. So here I am reducing it. Here is a question. What happens if I turn the sprinkler on? That's an action. I do sprinkler on. Here is the distribution in my neighborhood of those five variables. Okay, I decompose them according to this graph. It's just a product of sun conditional probability, sun giving parents, sun given parents. Good. What about if I do? If I do, I wipe out this factor and I replace it with a constant. Constant being it's true for and so on. So I remove this factor. So this is the post-intervention distribution. And notice that it's different than the different than the pre-intervention. It's also different than conditioning on the sprinkler being on. If the sprinkler was, if I see the sprinkler on, I can infer something about the season, about the rain. If I do sprinkler on, it should not affect, and it doesn't. Okay, so we have this calculus. And I'll skip that because I think this is the reasoning engine, something which you find in every exercise in causal reasoning. You have these steps. And this is how the machinery looks. When you're trying to reduce it to causal, to symbolic operations, you have three rules which have proven to be complete, in which you can take a sentence which has a mixture of seeing and doing and convert it to another sentence depending on what the graph tells you. If you have a certain license from the graph, you can make this transformation. So here I can remove an action. It's irrelevant according to the graph. Here I can replace, here I can replace an action by an observation. Here I can remove the action altogether and so on. Here's an example how you use it. Suppose we have the question of inferring what will happen if, what would be the probability of cancer if we ban smoking? But we don't have any information about this confounder, the genotype that make it perhaps makes people crave for nicotine, at the same time put them in a high cancer risk. So that is not observed. What's observed is only smoking, tar, and cancer. Can we then answer the question by symbolic calculus? Well, let's do the rules. I apply them like I do the rules of propositional logic, without even thinking. I'm thinking, because I know what I want to get. The answer would be a totally white formula. If I have a white formula, namely a formula without the do, it means I can infer it with passive observation. From a telephone book, I call people and say, do you smoke? Anybody in your family had cancer? And so on. This is results of passive observations. Ordinary conditional probability using Bayesian bar. These all rely on doing, on experiments, on randomized experiments, which is extremely expensive. So here's the possibility of reducing cost for the government. Instead of conducting experiments with banning cigarettes, I get the answer right there from observational studies, of course. I'm not rich, and I cannot save that money to the government, because it all relies on the assumption. The assumptions are the structure of the graph. But the assumptions are articulated in a language where epidemiologists can communicate to each other. Do you really believe that there's no line between smoking and cancer unless it goes through tower buildup? Okay. And so that's the second part which I like to emphasize. You articulate your assumption about reality in a language which you understand, it's a language through which you can vow for the veracity of the assumption. So, how am I doing on time? Let me see.
Still have
30
minutes.
30?
Yeah.
Terrific. Are you sure?
Yeah.
I never have so much time. Either I speak faster than I know than normal, or that you are such a good audience.
Very good audience. Yeah. I'm giving you a break.
Amazing. Good. Okay, so here's how it is manifested in sports medicine. When you face, it's the same problem that we had before, but now let's make it a little more, a little richer. So you are a sports medicine expert, and you're trying to find out if warm-up contributes to injury or prevents injury. And you have all these possible factors that you think could have effect. Okay? I can't even interpret some of them. But you put it down in a graph, and you say, this affects that, and this affects that, and so on. And the question is, which one should we measure? Some of them are extremely hard to measure. Some of them are noisy if you measure them. So it can't rely on the measurement. And can you get by with a few measurements as possible and still get assurance that you can extract an answer to your query? What is the query? Effect of warm-up on injury. Effect, I mean, if we do warm-up, what will be the distribution of injury? Okay. The answer is now given to us in a polynomial time algorithm. Give me any graph that you want. Ask me any query about that this type of question, and I'll tell you. If you manage to measure these two, you are done. If you can't, if they're too expensive, try this, you're also done. Don't adjust for previous injury. It will cause you bias, and so on. So I'll give you the subsets of variables that you ought to measure if you want to get unbiased estimate. And this is about average treatment effect. You can also ask more sophisticated questions such as, what is the effect of treatment on the treated? I don't care about the population as a whole, but those that were treated, because I want to know, for instance, if how is smoking affecting smokers? I'm not concerned about the population as a whole. Okay. How a social program affects those that are enrolled in the program, because I want to make sure that if government pays for programs, that the people who can benefit most from it are really getting, are registering, are enrolled in the program, and so on. So this is a counterfactual term, effect of treatment on the treatment. You cannot even express it with the do calculus. It's a counterfactual. And or probability of necessary causation. Suppose I saw somebody injured. What's the probability that he would not be injured had he not exercised? So now we're going to, I'm going to summarize and say there are a set of solved problems. And when I say solved, I mean mathematically solved. And by saying mathematically, I absolve myself from the responsibility of vowing for the assumptions. I go from assumptions to conclusion. Which means I tell you, if your graph is like that, I can tell you. I don't vow for the structure of the graph. I can tell you, however, if the graph has testable implication. Those you can test. And it so happens that many of the assumptions do not have testable implication in isolation, but coming together, they do have testable implication. So So that's why it's nice to be able to look at the graph and say, why don't you measure so-and-so? So-and-so being some maybe partial correlation, and see if you get what the graph dictates. So these are all solved problems. I just list them to give you a bird's-eye view of what we are able to solve mathematically. Okay. And I go to two other problems which is just being on the website, transportability and missing data. What is transportability? I decided before. When can causal relations learned from experiments be transferred to a different environment in which no experiments can be conducted? Okay. So we are thinking about training a robot in a cockpit or some simulation environment and letting the robot run into the field. We know ahead of time that there are differences between this environment and the next one. And we know qualitatively where they lie. We don't know how much. We don't talk quantities, only qualitatively. And the question is, given a description of the two environments, can you confirm or deny the transportability? So this is a computer science kind of determination. Yes or no? Does there exist an algorithm that will forgive the differences and still give you the right result? And you're also talking about statistical transportability, which is important for different reasons. Suppose only a subset of variables can be observed in the next environment. Here you spend all the time learning and learning and learning. Now you're going to a new environment. There are differences, but you allow only to measure few variables. Not everything is available to you. Or only a few samples are available, and you want to tease out as many samples as possible from the two environments. Because samples are precious in certain areas. Okay, let's look at the problem from a more formal viewpoint, graphical. This is the lab where you are trained, and now you are trying to transfer your knowledge to the real world. If the real world has the same structure as your lab, trivial answer. Take what you learn here, transfer it. If the real world is totally different, everything is different. You did experiments on monkeys, now you're trying to apply them to birds. Okay. The answer is also trivial. So for us computer scientists, the answer is trivial. Cannot be done. There isn't any algorithm that will do that. But what about in between? Here's an example. You did experiment in Los Angeles. You want to transfer it to New York City, and you find out that the age distribution is different. So in New York City, P star, the age P of Z is different than it was in Los Angeles. Okay? So we indicate that this by the square arrows, which tells you there are factors here that are responsible for the difference in age. Can you transfer it? Well, that's easy because that was done already by John Grout in 1676, somebody tell me. You just calibrate. Okay. You assume that the age-specific causal effect is invariant. So here you are. You weight by the prior probability of the age in New York City. But this is a causal problem, not a statistical problem, which means that the next question John Grout will not be able to solve. We say, suppose the story was different. It wasn't age. Z was really a language skill. Okay? I can show you two distributions, P, X, Y, Z. They have the same distribution as before, but Z plays a different role in the causal story. Would the answer be the same? Calibrate for Z? Answer is no. Here the true answer is transfer it as is, because language skill has no effect on X and Y. Go further. Suppose Z is a biomarker sitting between X and Y. I can make P of X, Y, Z the same as before. The answer is different now. The transfer formula is now has to be weighted by the conditional probability of Z X. The point is not that you follow the derivation, but that you agree with me that the correct answer depends on a causal story and not on a distribution. So people in machine learning that are trying to do transfer learning ought to be aware that the true answer depends on the causal story and not on the distribution. The goal is now to get any complex graph that you think. That graph describes two environments. These boxes represent areas where you suspect differences between the two environments. I can express it in one graph and ask the question, hey, is the problem transportable or not? If so, give me the measurement to be taken in both environments and how to combine them so as to get the answer to my query. We have theorems, we have algorithms, just shown to be complete. Complete is very important, which means that no one can do better. Okay. But if we say it cannot be done, then no smart aleck can invent an algorithm that will say, here I do it. Okay, I still have time, right? According to the latest, yes, 15 minutes. You said so.
Oh.
Misled me.
I think you have about five.
No. You have to stick to your.
Yeah.
Give me 10, okay?
I'll give you
10. No, if it's boring, stop me. I go one step further. I talk about big data now. Big dream. I have measurements taken in every hospital in the United States, okay? And I want to look at all the measurements that I've taken and infer what will be the effect of X on Y in Arkansas. I've never been there. But I make assumptions here that these are the differences between the environment. Some of the studies were taken on all variables. Some of them you forgot to take Z, and some of them have differences from the target. Wherever you have bugs, I suspect there is a difference. Okay? And the question is, can you do it? Well, the answer is yes. We have an algorithm, a polynomial time algorithm, that can look at them and say, doable or not doable. Which means there exists an algorithm. It takes all the measurements, scramble it, massage it, synthesize the unbiased estimate of the target quantity. I'll skip you the theorem, and I'll go to missing data. This is an area where it's very pervasive in every experimental science. Okay. I cannot think of a science that is not plagued by missing data. People don't want to answer questions for different reasons. You know? People who make high income are sometimes ashamed of their high income, and vice versa. Those who make low income are ashamed of them. Don't divulge. In the commander systems, people press, give you a response if they like it or loathe it, but not in between. So you have missing data for a reason which depends on the variables that you want to measure. Can you recover it? It's a huge literature, normally dominated by statistical vocabulary, but it's inherently causal. And what we need is theoretical guidance and performance guarantee and test of assumptions. So here's what the question that we ask now. Again, conforming to the Greek science. Okay, we ask questions about reality and not about the data. That's a change here. What should the world be like for a given statistical procedure to produce the expected result? Can we tell from the postulated world whether any method can produce a bias-free result and how? And then can we tell if our postulated world has testable implication? Here's the example. This is what a missing data analyst faces. You have variables that you want to measure, X, Y, Z. You don't measure them. You measure X star, Y star, Z star. They are corrupted by missing, unavailable. Okay. And you want to take this fancy table, corrupted table, and answer a very simple question, estimate the marginal probability or the joint probability P of X, Y, Z. Can you do it? Well, it turns out it depends on how the data is generated. So you have to tell me, here's reality. Here's my postulate about the data generating model. Here is what I observe. It is a result of two things. First, the variable that I want to measure, X. It also depends on whether there is a mechanism that masks S, that eliminates it from the record. I give it a name, a variable name, R sub X. It's a missingness mechanism. Okay. which in itself depends on other variables in the domain. So we have a graph which is sprinkled with the variable we need to measure, plus the R variables that masks once in a while for various reasons. And I assume that I know the reasons, which means I assume that I know the parents of Rx, because they determine. I don't know the probabilities, of course, only the structure. Now the game is different. The game is, this is obvious, that you see only things, you see the correct things if Rx is missing. It's dormant. But when Rx is triggered, all you see is an M. Now, let's continue. A simple trick would be to look at only complete cases. So you dump it here and ignore all the rest. And we know that from probability theory that that is biased. It could be biased because it amounts to saying that if you were to condition on the R's, you'll get the same result. But the graph doesn't confirm the conditional independence here that you presume, unknowingly perhaps. But by resorting to a complete deletion, you essentially made the assumption that the R variables are independent on the variable that you want to measure, okay? Which is wrong in this graph, which is right in this graph, which is called MCAR. But in between, you have cases like that. Okay? Some of the variables, some of the R variables are related or caused by the XYZ measurement, the variables, and some are not depending on them, but they depend through other variables, which in themselves can be either missing or not missing. So we have now a problem of interaction, entanglement between missing and not missing variables. 2 minutes, beautiful. You know what you can do in 2 minutes? Look at it. You can prove to people that even if you have a graph as complex as that, okay, you can get an unbiased estimate by simply decomposing things in a smart way. I call it a smart estimate. If you know the structure of the graph, I decompose it in such a way that I can insert the Rx equal to zero at the right time for the right set of variables and get a decomposition. Each of its term, you know, is conditioned on the Rx. The graph gives me the license to condition it by conditional independence. The graph is a good conveyor of conditional independences. So I can come to that and get an unbiased estimate. I can also have a definition of something we call recoverability, namely the existence of an algorithm that guarantees an unbiased estimate of your target quantity, as if unbiased means that if this, in the limit of large samples, Q is estimable as if no data was missing. And here's an example, or here's a theorem. It tells it is sufficient condition. We have also some sufficient and necessary conditions. Let me go to the interesting stuff. The interesting stuff is, here's an example of a graph that gives me the verdict. It's recoverable. Both Q1 and Q2 are recoverable. Here's a graph now, which cannot be distinguished from the first, and gives me a different verdict. It's not recoverable. It's a different story, of course. It's a different story. Here I give you the story. And the verdict is non-recoverable, which means that you have an impossibility theory for missing data, which means, here, no universal algorithm exists that decide recoverability without looking at the model. Most of the software today that you can buy for missing data are operating on the data. They decide what to do depending on the data, not on the model. Okay? They are bound to fail in some models and maybe succeed in others. Even a stronger, even if the non-biased estimate exists behind the scene, you're still going to need to consult the model. And I'm going to finish with being conclusions, deduction. This is a turtle shell. Deduction, going from assumptions to conclusion, is indispensable in causal inference as it is in science and machine learning. think nature, not data, not even experiments. Experiments reveal the structure of nature, but you think about nature first. And counterfactual can be algorithmatized, and all these nice terms which you hear in the neighboring department, testability, recoverability, transportability, have a formal solution and computational algorithms. And I repeat, think nature, not data. Sorry that I have to repeat it so many times. Thank you for inviting.